The heroes of my movies have always been the head lobbyist for big tobacco, or a pregnant teenage girl, or a guy who fires people for a living, or a woman who's trying to ruin someone else's marriage. I have a strange concept of what a hero is, and I've always seen the things that you just referred to as really locations. Smoking is a location for a movie about freedom of choice, and in this case, technology is a location for a movie about relationships and intimacy. And what I loved about the book was that it found a way into kind of the raw details of what it's like to be in love in 2014.
Jason, we have a couple of British connections to this, the composer, Bibio, but I do have to ask you the Emma Thompson question, I feel. Why was her cut glass British accent the one you wanted? I mean, she sure has a way of delivering that porno language.
Yeah, when Aaron Cressida Wilson, my co-writer, and I started adapting Chad's novel, we wanted to find a way to work in all of Chad's narration and description. And we imagined Voyager, this spacecraft, which we launched in the 70s, looking back on Earth. And we thought, who would be the voice of Voyager, looking back on humanity, giving us this kind of cold but humorous look, as though observing animals in the wild. And we just started thinking about Emma's voice. It's how witty it is, how smart it is, and how she gets away with being naughty in a really intelligent way. And I don't know anyone else who can do that. So it went from being, wow, that's a good idea, to a desperation and hope that she would say yes. And I actually met her last year at Toronto Film Festival and suggested the film, and she read it. And when she recorded it all in one fell swoop. She did a few changes along the way, but we met at a rock and roll studio in Hollywood, and she threw the whole thing down without ever watching a frame of the film.
Jason, it's not that long since you made Juno, and I wonder if you can go back and making another film that focuses so heavily on teenagers and high school life. Were you shocked at the rapid change in the landscape in terms of the way that teenagers are prepared to live their private lives in public?
100%. It's funny because, you know, Juno was made in 2006 or 2007, and we had set it just a little bit earlier just so we could get away from cell phones. And yeah, it's been, God, 7 or 8 years, and we've gone from the hamburger phone to the iPhone. I mean, that's the transition from Juno to this film. And from touring high schools on Juno and seeing these buildings that were built in the 60s and 70s, and everything was made out of wood, and in trying to capture the feel of what high school was then, to now, where we were touring a school in Texas where there were no lockers because there are no books. And there were device days and non-device days. And there were classrooms where kids had earbuds in the middle of class. And I asked an administrator, what are they listening to? And he said, I don't know, maybe music?
You mentioned co-writing the screenplay with Erin Cressida Wilson. And why did you want to collaborate on this? I mean, she has written for the screen herself and for stage, and she's a professor of language and English, isn't she?
That I didn't know until this very moment. But, Erin is the last thing from a prude. She wrote Secretary, and she wrote Fur, and she wrote Chloe, and I've known her for a while. We worked together on Chloe, and I ran into her at the Sundance Film Festival in the hallway of the Marriott, and I'd been, you know, Helen and I had been talking about this book for a while, and how could this possibly be a movie? Every time we would talk about Men, Women, and Children, I would think of the poster of Lolita, which used to say, how could they make a movie out of Lolita? And that's how I felt about this book. And I saw Erin Cressida, and I thought, oh, I think if we did this together, we could accomplish it. And there was something about our mutual point of view, having a man and a woman write this together. There was a flirtation to writing this movie and adapting it. We had these index cards. You know, writers often use index cards to break down a screenplay. And they were the funniest index cards of all time because the descriptions of scenes would be like, Don masturbates to son's computer. Next index card. It's a complicated thing to make a movie about young people in 2014, because if you really examine our life, if you were to take a teenager today and try to make a movie about their day-to-day, 3/4 of their day would be a young person staring at a glass, at a piece of glass, which is not very cinematic. And you have the need to see what someone, you need to be able to see a conversation that's happening between a person and a device rather than two human beings. So early on, Aaron and I started talking about the ways that we could display what people are looking at on screen and somehow make that part of the film plane. And I was looking at my computer desktop at one point, and I thought, well, what if the film plane was the desktop image and every icon, every window, every tab was floating on top of that? Which was a fun idea, but it became a very tricky thing to accomplish because we had to create negative space and create production design that would allow for all these things to take place, and then also relearn how to edit a movie in which you're not only tracking a person on screen, but track all the photos and text messages and everything else that appears, so that's interactive. The funny thing in watching the movie with audiences is that we're also well trained at doing that now. We keep 10 apps open on our iPhone at once. If we're on our computer, we have music playing, we're searching two things, we're replying to an email, we're in the midst of an IM conversation, we're checking our Facebook, and we're so good at that now that watching a film where all these things take place is actually quite easy. Adapting a novel is fantastic because you get to take credit for someone else's genius and you have a writing partner who simply provides you with great words and doesn't argue with anything. I'm half kidding, but that's kind of true, right? There's questions that are burning away at me, and like anybody. And I read a book, and I would think I have the same response that anyone does, that somehow this author has articulated something that I've been feeling and have not been able to put into words. And in the few cases where, we've made movies, it's because the moment I start reading them, not only am I feeling that connection with the author, but I'm seeing a movie. It's just begins to play in my head. And that happened the first time I read Thank You for Smoking, happened the first time I read Up in the Air. I just start seeing the shots, I see Clooney in the airport. And in this one, there was something fun about how could we possibly portray this movie on screen? There's so many personal private moments. And that's what we're living in the moment of, right? We're living in the moment of exposed private moments because we are being more... I just heard a TED Talk recently that said, our search engines know more about us than our closest loved ones and our family. And I think that's true. So we're in the midst of exposing our secrets and having these interesting private moments. And the book somehow captured what it was like to be with teenagers, male, female, adults, married, divorced, what those private moments were like, and what it was like to be in between their fingertips and their screens. This is a complicated moment that I don't think anyone can quite understand. I feel like we're the Cro-Magnons at the beginning of 2001, and that giant black slab shows up, we touch the slab and we are instantaneously given knowledge, and that Cro-Magnon grabs the tibia bone and kills the other Cro-Magnon for the watering hole. I think that's the stage where we're at as far as the internet goes, and we're not going to be able to fully understand this moment for another 50 years, and we'll look back and realize we were wandering in the dark trying to figure out issues of privacy and issues of what we share and who are the characters that we create for ourselves online. You can't be anywhere close to my age and not love John Hughes. He's the guy who took young people seriously. And he was the first guy who did that. He made movies about young people that took their human drama and made it real. What you said is exactly right. I think to be 15 is to feel as though you have cancer. It is to feel as though you are dying and the weight of the world is on your shoulders. Certainly we tried to emulate that on Juno, and certainly we tried to emulate that on this film. Things have not changed, it's just the landscape has. But the teenagers are the same. Adam Sandler and I met a few years ago, and in him I found an actor and a storyteller who was much closer to my heart than I would have initially presumed. When we started talking about stories we wanted to tell, they were the same stories. And we began working on a few different things. And when this movie came up, we had a movie that started with a man trying to log on to a pornography site, but his computer had too much spam, so he goes into his teenage son's bedroom and uses his son's computer instead. And it ends with a husband and wife having a very complicated conversation about whether or not they should be completely honest with each other. I needed an actor who was not only great, but was accessible. And I couldn't think of a more perfect person than Sandler to do it. And we talked for a while about it. He had a lot of questions about how he was going to portray it and what the film meant and what the last scene meant. But the more we talked, the more I knew in my heart, this is the perfect guy for it. And it was a great moment for us when he said yes, and I can't think of a better way for the film to open and close than with him. And he was absolutely lovely on set. I've never had an actor do this. Every day, I'm not even sure if I told you about this, if he wasn't shooting, he would text me and ask how everyone else was doing. How's Ansel doing? How's Rosemary doing? Which scene are you doing today? What are they serving for lunch today? How's the cut going? He would check in about everything.
He still texts me all the time.
Yeah.
It's like so nice. I'm like, that's Adam Sandler texting me. I was like, by the way, I just watched Waterboy last night.
How's my boy? Yeah. No, he was fantastic. What was unbelievable is we had these eight young actors who ranged in age from like 15 to 22 years old. And considering the amount of tricky material they were taking on, and each one was dealing with something difficult with their character, they came so mature, so confident, and created a friendship within each other that made the set a very exciting place to be. We shot the teenagers in December, and we shot the adults in January. December was about young love, and January was about marriages falling apart. It made for a very interesting pre-Christmas and post-Christmas shoot. You know, it's funny. I mean, I suppose every director has that one actor who somehow speaks their voice. And apparently my voice is a guy in his... You alright there, buddy?
Yeah, I choked on water.
Is a guy in his mid-50s who can terrify people the way he does in Whiplash. I don't know what it is, but there's a natural bond that started on that movie. And I can't imagine making movies without him. And I'm envious, actually, of what an amazing job that Damien did with him on Whiplash. I remember Paul Thomas Anderson once said about Fargo, I wanted to be the guy that directed Bill Macy to that performance. And I look at J.K. and Whiplash, and I go, I want to be the guy who directed J.K. Simmons to that performance. I have become more conscientious of it, and I certainly think a lot about it when it comes to my daughter. I think I'm more conscientious of when I'm on my phone in front of my daughter than anything else. And there's something about it, for whatever reason, there's something in the back of my head. It's funny, I remember when I made Thank You for Smoking, there was a woman I knew who was in politics, and I was so excited to be making a libertarian movie, and she said, I wonder what will change when you become a father, and I said, I will never change. And there's something about when I'm on my phone in front of my daughter that makes me want to put my phone in my pocket.